we set various other conditions for making sure that, all those funds are unfrozen, which you know about.
Today at 6, a public inquiry into child sexual abuse within religious groups finds shocking failings. We hear from a survivor as the inquiry finds blatant hypocrisy in the way dozens of religious groups deal with the issue.
The sense of powerlessness and hopelessness, because I didn't fully recognise what was going on at the time was wrong.
This latest inquiry follows others into abuse in the Catholic and Protestant faiths. Also tonight, the subway flooded, road and rail lines out of action, at least 15 dead as Hurricane Ida's tail lashes New York, New Jersey and the northeast of America. The Foreign Secretary is in the Gulf trying to negotiate more evacuations from Afghanistan. He says Britain will have to engage with the Taliban.
Sarah Story, record breaker, history maker.
You're looking at the most successful British Paralympian of them all. Dame Sarah Story bags a 17th gold. Ever since this, we've been waiting for this. 40 years on, ABBA are ready to make music again, and we'll have a preview of a new tune.
And coming up on the BBC News Channel, from the Euros to the World Cup, England are in Hungary as they continue their qualifying campaign for Qatar 2022.
Good evening and welcome to the BBC's News at 6. A public inquiry has found blatant hypocrisy in the way major religious groups handle allegations of child abuse. The independent inquiry into child sexual abuse said dozens of religious organisations within Christianity, Orthodox Judaism and Islam were morally failing children. The report follows similar inquiries into the Catholic and Protestant faiths. This inquiry found that religious leaders discourage the reporting of abuse to protect the reputations of their groups. Our Home Affairs correspondent Tom Simons has the details.
It's very difficult to form an identity and to be a whole person when you are on your own.
This is Sarah, born into the Jehovah's Witnesses, into a family dominated by the church.
Effectively, you were sexually abused by both your father and your mother.
Yeah.
Your father when you were much younger, and your mother when you were a little bit older, and they had control over you. What was that like?
I don't really have words to describe what that was like, honestly. The sense of powerlessness and hopelessness.
Sarah's not her real name. She was taken into care. She settled by the sea for a new start, away from the witnesses.
They teach that everyone who is not a witness is part of Satan's world, or Satan's system, as they call it. That makes you, as a young person, terrified to trust anyone outside of the organisation, and at the same time, terrified to trust anyone inside of the organisation. It was very difficult.
It's a pattern repeated across 38 religious groups investigated by this inquiry, which has also examined the Catholic and Anglican churches.
The way that leaders are revered, the the culture of community and not taking things outside of the community. So dealing with everything internally, not making outside authorities aware so that it can be looked at in the wider sense, and making sure that the root causes of it are tackled. Discouraging victims from reporting, even within the organisation.
An example, the Jehovah's Witnesses have a policy that all child protection allegations have to be reported to the police. But inside the church, they also follow a biblical scripture, which says that all allegations must be supported by two witnesses. This report says that the two-witness rule should have no place in any response to child sexual abuse, which often happens with no witnesses. The church says it's committed to protecting children and will consider this report. In the Orthodox Jewish community, the inquiry heard about the concept of mesira, not snitching, as one witness put it, on a fellow Jew to outsiders. But campaigners are concerned that this report does not hit religious organisations hard enough.
They have to raise the bar for religious organisations and not give them leeway because they have religion on their side. Religion does not equal good enough safeguarding.
The report is short on a solution to all this, but that's what those who suffered as children, including Sarah, are now using their adult voices to demand.
And Tom is with me now. Tom, is there any sense of how
Hello
this
and welcome
be
to Thursday's programme.
Solutions,
coming up tonight,
that's what we all want to see, isn't
exams.
It? I mean, Sarah's case is just one among many, and this report covered really religious organisations across the spectrum. It was careful not to point at any one organisation. But this is only part of the final work of this inquiry, which has been going on for some years now. They've done more than a dozen investigations into all walks of life and the child abuse failures that have taken place there. The big report is next year. It's going to be the final report by the independent inquiry. And they have one big decision, I think, to make, and that is whether to back a big change in the law, which is to introduce it a reason to make people report child abuse, which has been one of the threads running through all of this. A change called mandatory reporting, which would say that it is a criminal offence if you have a reason, if you're in a position to report some concerns you have, not to do so. It's a controversial topic, it's legally tricky, but it's a big decision the inquiry has to make.
All right, Tom, thanks very much. At least 15 people have died after flash flooding and tornadoes hit northeastern parts of America. New York and New Jersey declared a state of emergency as people were trapped in flooded basements and vehicles were swept away. Around 3 inches, that's 8 centimetres of rain, fell in just 1 hour in parts of New York. Our North America correspondent, Nada Taufik, is in New Jersey for us. Nada.
Well, Hurricane Ida has now devastated two major regions of the United States. Here in the Northeast, there was no anticipation or warning that the storm's remnants would be this destructive and life-threatening. In this town in New Jersey, a 70-year-old man in his car was swept away by the floods. And in New York, the youngest victim was just 2 years old.
Cascading waterfalls rush through the platforms down to the tracks of New York City's subway. The sudden deluge from Ida's move up north shut down the network and didn't stop there. A state of emergency was called as the city became paralyzed by record-breaking rain and flash flooding, turning wide boulevards quickly into waterways.
Good work!
Motorists and a few out working despite the obstacles waded through the water to get home. Meanwhile, others were stranded as some flights and service on Amtrak ground to a halt. At the U.S. Open, players and spectators were caught by surprise as Ida slammed through the stadium's retractable roof, interrupting this match. In Mamaroneck in Westchester, residents were rescued from the rising waters on their doorsteps.
I'm not for nothing. We're homeless right now. But this all, you know, we're all going to come together and we're going to figure out a solution. And we'll go from there.
Others weren't so lucky, and today officials are still discovering the true death toll. Democratic Mayor Bill de Blasio warned that with climate change, the region was going to become more prone to these extreme weather events.
A record set 2 weeks ago, another record set now, rainfall like we haven't seen ever before. This is the biggest wake-up call we could possibly get. We're going to have to do a lot of things differently and quickly.
In Philadelphia, there was no telling where the Delaware River ended and suburbs began. Rescuers went door to door by boat, helping people escape who took shelter in the upper floors of their homes and on their roofs. The devastating impact of this storm is still coming into view. In this town in New Jersey, a powerful tornado, the like seen normally in the Midwest, obliterated homes. People are now beginning to pick up the pieces of their lives blown apart by Ida as the storm claims more victims. Neda Taufik, BBC News, New Jersey.
The Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab has been visiting Qatar as part of a regional tour to arrange safe passage for those Afghans still left in the country who have the right to settle in the UK. For example, those who worked for British forces. There are also a number of British nationals. It's not clear how many people are involved, but ministers have been saying it's in the low hundreds. In the last few minutes, Boris Johnson says the Taliban must prioritise safe passage for those who want to leave. Our chief international correspondent, Lise Doucette, has been speaking to one contractor who worked at the former British embassy.
Oh, there's Christmas.
Yeah.
Christmas parties, diplomatic dinners, daily meals. Head chef Hamid was part of British Embassy life in Kabul for 13 years. This was the last meeting of kitchen staff with the British Ambassador, Sir Laurie Bristow. He spent days at Kabul Airport overseeing the massive airlift. Hamid and about 60 others were left behind because they weren't employed by the Foreign Office, but through a private contractor.
We worked so hard, even during the COVID lockdown, and we're left behind. I feel I have been betrayed. If they don't take us out of here, it's a big betrayal.
Now this family of five young children is hiding at home. Many are doing the same. Today, in the Gulf state of Qatar, the BBC asked the Foreign Secretary about the contractors. He admitted many need help.
We will not be recognising the Taliban anytime in the foreseeable future. But I think there is an important scope for engagement and dialogue and to test the intentions and indeed the assurances that have already been made by the Taliban. Safe passage out of Afghanistan for, and I'm afraid to my friend from the BBC, I didn't mention it, but to those Afghan workers or contractors who are eligible and still want to come to the UK or indeed other countries.
There's a battle at home. Brave women take to the streets in the western city of Herat. Don't be scared, we are all together, is their rallying cry. Worried the Taliban will stop them from working or studying as they did before. Mariam Rajai has moved from one safe house to the next ever since the Taliban swept into Kabul. She'd been working on issues like gender and human rights. The Taliban told her, don't come to the office for now. Many fear they'll never be allowed to go back.
As a human, it's my right to get education. It's my right to have a good job. Unfortunately, this situation that came in Afghanistan, all of my dreams destroyed.
Kabul looks much the same, but it's not.
A nation at war now seems to be a nation in waiting. So many Afghans wondering, worrying, what kind of new government will emerge with all of its rules and regulations? Many others still asking ever so anxiously, how can they escape?
For now, so many lives are on pause. Lise Doucette, BBC News, Kabul.
And now for the latest UK coronavirus figures. They show there were just over 38,000 new infections recorded in the latest 24-hour period, which means an average of 33,736 per day in the last week. The latest figures show there were over 7,500 people in hospital being treated for coronavirus yesterday. 178 deaths were reported in the latest 24-hour period. That's people who died within 28 days of a positive COVID-19 test. That takes the average deaths per day over the last week to 111. And on vaccinations, 88.6% of people aged 16 and over have now had their first jab. and just over 79% of the population aged 16 and over have had both doses. As a new school year gets underway, students in England can expect a much more normal experience. That was the assurance from Education Secretary Gavin Williamson today. Masks and bubbles may have gone, but secondary pupils are still being encouraged to take regular tests, and schools are being asked to ensure classrooms are well ventilated. Our education editor, Bramwell Jeffries, reports from Colchester.
Circle five times on each side.
Okay, the first test is the hardest. For these year sevens, the first time in secondary school too. The parents told me it's worth it as a step back towards normality.
We're happy to comply with what we need to do because I think it's for the best for everyone.
I think because of the last year we've had has been so unsettling, just to be normal, get back to it.
There's still, you know, certain things that aren't normal, like coming in today for her first ever day here. She's coming in and having to do a lateral flow test. You know, sooner that we move away from that stuff, the better. I appreciate that they've got to do it at the moment.
I'm hoping that nothing like Corona doesn't spread anymore, like how it did last year, how it just happened so quickly and largely.
School staff have been vaccinated. Precautions today were to get accurate results. After this, teenagers will be asked to test at home.
Testing is now the main precaution in England's schools. Masks have gone for pupils, and so have big year group bubbles. But both of those could be back on a local basis if cases rise. It's now much more up to schools to decide what precautions to put in place.
There's a lot less signage up. We don't.
No one-way signs.
No one-way signs anymore.
For head teachers, more leeway to make decisions.
What we do know now is what's worked over the last 2 years, especially with last year as well. So we could draw on maybe putting bubbles together again. We could introduce face masks in different areas, making sure seating plans are set up in the right way. There's lots and lots of different things that we can draw on from what we know has worked in the last year.
For year 11s, it's a crucial GCSE year. So what are their hopes?
Yeah, so I think exams at the end of the year, hopefully not another lockdown, of course.
I'm quite relieved because I felt quite trapped in the mask and it was quite annoying just going around school in the mask all the time.
I hope that it will really help people's mental health because I know lots of people who's in like my friendship groups, they've really had a hit on their mental health.
Pupils went back to school in Scotland 2 weeks ago. They've kept masks for the start of term, but even so, cases have risen rapidly. A reminder, the same may happen as schools open in the rest of the UK. Bramwell Jeffries, BBC News, Colchester.
The time is 17 minutes past six. Our top story this evening. Victims respond after a public inquiry into religious groups finds shocking failings in the way they handled child sexual abuse. And coming up, a good start for England on the first day of the fourth test against India, but a tense evening of play.
Coming up in Sports Day on the BBC News Channel, England's bowlers make another sensational start against India on the first day of the fourth test at the Oval.
Dame Sarah Storey has become Britain's most successful Paralympian of all time. She successfully defended her C4-5 cycling road race title in Tokyo earlier this morning. That's three golds at the Tokyo Games and the 17th gold of her career, which began, listen to this, back at the 1992 Games in Barcelona. Andy Swiss reports.
Hurtling into history, the moment Dame Sarah Storey went where no British Paralympian has gone before. Amid torrential rain, though, how she had to work for it, Storey stayed out of trouble before surging clear with teammate Crystal Lane Wright and sprinting to glory. The result, an unprecedented feat for British sport.
17th Paralympic gold medal for her.
It is the culmination of a remarkable career. Born without a functioning left hand, Story started as a swimmer. She was just 14 when she won her first Paralympic gold, before she switched to cycling with now record-breaking results. Her 17th title, so special.
To be Britain's most successful Paralympian, how does that sound?
I like the sound of that. It's something that I never anticipated happening to me. If you'd asked me that when I was 14, I'd have been, oh, well, yeah, maybe to go on to eclipse the record. That's something that I could never have even imagined happening.
It's now nearly 30 years since Story made her Paralympic debut, but those closest to her say her drive and determination are stronger than ever.
She's just amazing, like how she manages to find new ways, being in different environment chambers at high altitude, just to push her body even more. And she's just able to do that. And I think there are very few people in the world that are able to do that.
Well, the very British weather here has seen a landmark moment for British sport. And with Dame Sarah Story already targeting the next Games in 2024, who knows how many more titles she could win. It wasn't Britain's only cycling success. Victory for Ben Watson in the road race. There was also gold in the pool as Bethany Firth took the 100 metres backstroke. And in the athletics, there was javelin joy for Dan Pembroke. And just look what it meant. But the result of the day was in the 200 metres. A Paralympic proposal for Cape Verde's Coelen Andrea Pereira Semedo from her guide runner Manuel. And to everyone's delight, she said yes. Talk about a fairy tale finish. Andy Swiss, BBC News, Tokyo.
100 organisations, from charities to teachers, have signed an open letter to the Prime Minister, urging him not to go ahead with the planned cut to universal credit. An extra £20 a week was added to the scheme at the start of the pandemic as a temporary measure and is due to be phased out from the end of this month. The government says its focus now is on creating more jobs. Here's our social affairs correspondent, Michael Buchanan.
I don't know why they call it early morning work because
it's the first day of school for Douglas and the resumption of his daily trek. The 8-year-old and his mum Tasha travel 8 miles on 2 buses.
No. Hiya, can I get
as Douglas didn't get a place at a nearby primary after they moved home last year.
Thank you.
The family of 6 rely on universal credit to top up dad's wages as a builder. The bus journey costs £5.20 daily.
It's not that busy today, is it?
And is reimbursed by their council each term. But the family have to pay up front, and the looming benefit cut will create tough choices.
If we lose that money, he will only be able to go to school basically 3 days a week because we won't be able to afford it, because otherwise we're going to have to cut our food bill down. And then also, what do we do? Do we eat or do we get into school? And it sounds bad, but education's going to have to go.
It just annoys me that they give us it in one hand, and we're a working family. I've always worked. I'm only not working because obviously I've got the 1-year-old, so we're stuck. I don't want to rely on universal credit, but we have no choice.
Last week at Bridlington Beach in Yorkshire, Unite the Union organised this sand sculpture to highlight their opposition to the government's plan. Today's open letter to the Prime Minister is signed by groups representing education, housing, the economy, healthcare and anti-poverty campaigners.
We're facing a crossroads where the government faces a choice. It has said it is committed to improving the lives of people on the lowest incomes, but the depth of that commitment will be revealed this autumn when it decides whether or not to go ahead with this cut to the incomes of the poorest people in our country.
Ministers say the extra £20 a week was always meant to be temporary and that they're now focused on helping people to either find work or earn more. For award-winning opera singer Emily Parry-Williams, work is currently not an option. The pandemic forced her onto universal credit like millions of others. After all, her work was cancelled. The arts have not recovered. She still has few bookings. So she finds the benefit cut extraordinary.
We don't want to be on universal credit, we want to get back to work. So then to reduce that money anymore, when it's incredibly low anyway, it feels like a betrayal.
For many, the benefit cut will coincide with steep energy price rises, but it will save the Treasury billions of pounds. Michael Buchanan, BBC News.
Let's take a look at some of today's other news. A Conservative MSP has apologised for implying that Nicola Sturgeon was anti-English during First Minister's questions. Ms Sturgeon called the accusation deeply offensive. Tess White, who represents North East Scotland, has conceded her remarks were over the line. WhatsApp has been fined £193 million by Ireland's data watchdog for breaching privacy regulations. The fine relates to an investigation into whether WhatsApp had been transparent enough about how it handles information. Facebook, which owns WhatsApp, has its EU headquarters in Ireland, which is why the fine has been issued by the Irish regulator. WhatsApp says it plans to appeal. In America, the US Supreme Court has refused to block a new law passed in Texas that bans abortion after 6 weeks of pregnancy. President Biden has called the ruling an unprecedented assault on women's constitutional rights. Cricket and England got off to a good start against India on the first day of the fourth test at the Oval. Sent into bat, India lost a string of early wickets and were bowled out for 191 runs. But England lost two quick wickets and a short while ago were 52 for two. Adam Wilde was watching.
Ringing in the day's play, this now the sound of the Oval Test. For all the modernisation, cricket remains a game of tradition. The morning rendition of Jerusalem is one. Jimmy Anderson opening the England bowling has become another. But for all the familiarity, this is a series of fluctuating fortunes, no more so than for Chris Wokes.
Welcome back, Chris Wokes.
A year out of Test cricket, here announcing his return. When Anderson dismissed Chateshwar Pujara before lunch, India was struggling. Virat Kohli made it to 50, but having been dropped once, England wouldn't let him go again. But such is this series, now wildly unpredictable. India, like England, are as beatable as they can be brilliant. In a display of batting belligerence, Shardul Thakur gave India something from the day. A day England's opening batsmen just had to see out. Instead, they got themselves out, the game shifting once more. And amidst cricket's traditions, nothing is certain here. Adam Wilde, BBC News.
The Greek composer Mikis Theodorakis, who found worldwide fame with his score to the 1960s film Zorba the Greek, has died at the age of 96. Theodorakis produced a huge range of music, from opera to popular songs. He was arrested in the late 60s because of his opposition to the military coup in Greece and had his music banned in the country because of his left-wing politics. Now, of all the musical reunions we fantasise about, surely the return of ABBA has to be up there at the top. Well, it's about to happen. Bjorn, Agnetha, Benny and Annefrid are coming together again after 40 years. A new album is on its way and they'll appear in concert, but in a way they've never done before. Arts correspondent David Sillitoe is live at London's Olympic Park. David.
Well, I am on the top of the Orbit Tower because this is where an announcement is taking place at the moment. Whenever anyone from ABBA has been spoken to over the last 40 years or so, there has always been one question. Will there ever be a reunion? Well, in the last few minutes, inside there, the answer, finally, is yes.
I still have faith in you. I see it now.
40 years after recording their last album, a new ABBA song. Indeed, a new ABBA album. And this video of the group finally back together.
First it was just two songs. And then we said, well, maybe we should do, I don't know, a few others. What do you say, girls? And they say, yeah. Then I asked them, well, why don't we just do a whole album?
It's 47 years since the band hit the big time with the Eurovision-winning Waterloo, the beginning of a series of number one hits and global success.
Ladies and gentlemen, ABBA.
8 years later, this was their final TV appearance on British television. Every year since then, a question. Will they ever perform again, together, And the answer finally is yes, sort of.
And the reason the announcement is taking place here in the Olympic Park is because this is where the ABBA concerts are going to be taking place. But you're not going to be seeing ABBA as they are today, but rather with a degree of digital youthful enhancement.
The group has been performing in a studio, and with the aid of motion capture digital effects, the image we'll see out here on stage will be the band members in their 70s heyday, to create, after the musicals and movies, another ABBA experience. But what makes this moment different is the new music, the new album, The Reunion, 40 years on. David Sillitoe, BBC News.
Time for a look at the weather now. Stav Deneos has it. Follow that, Stav.
Oh, I knew you'd say that, George. Thank you very much. Good evening to you. Mixed fortunes of weather again today. Glorious sunny conditions across much of Scotland, Northern Ireland, Northern England. Look at this lovely picture in the Highlands there. That's Glencoe, of course, under the blue sky. Further south, we had a blanket of cloud. And again, it was a bit disappointing temperature-wise with the breeze coming in off the North Sea. Here, this cloudy picture in Northamptonshire. And it's this area of high pressure which is bringing us this contrasting weather. It's going to bring more cloud again across the country as we head through this evening and overnight. That blanket of cloud covering most areas, in fact. But again, it's western Scotland, parts of Northern Ireland, and maybe parts of southern England, southeast, southwest Wales could stick out in some clearer skies. Where its skies are clear is going to be quite cool. For most, under that blanket of cloud, 11 to 14 degrees. So we do all again on Friday. It's another rather grey, cloudy start, bit of mist and murk around. But then favoured spots will start to see some sunshine developing. And that's, those areas are Scotland, parts of Northern Ireland, Northern England again, and perhaps across southern England too. And where you get the sunshine, it'll be warm, low 20 Celsius, where it stays rather grey and cloudy, then mid to high teens. The subtle changes we head on into the weekend, our area of high pressure eventually starts to shift. It pushes over towards the near continent. Low pressure starts to approach from the southwest. For Saturday, though, we're in a run of more southeasterly winds. So again, a rather cloudy start to the day. There will be some holes breaking through in that cloud, and even a few showers developing across southern and western areas into the afternoon as temperatures begin to rise. Because I think if we start to see increased amounts of sunshine across the south, those temperatures could be reaching the low to mid-20s. Otherwise, it's the mid to high teens. Sunday, we see some rain across northern areas. It starts to warm up in the south, and then many areas will be turning much warmer into the start of next week. George.
Thank you, Stav. And that's all from the BBC's News at 6. So it's goodbye from me, and on BBC One, we can now join the BBC's news teams where you are.